can see one picture. What they're telling us, in the past, Sir Isaac Newton discovered gravitation in the 17th century. The Earth's gravitational force acts in a direction opposite to that of an object moving upwards. Hence, the speed of that object goes on decreasing till in the end it becomes zero. Then the object starts falling down instead of going up, and further, while falling, its speed goes on increasing all the time due to gravitational force. Now, next question is, let us try this. See, in front of you, you can see picture dropping a stone in water. Now, see what they're telling us. Number one, take a small stone and a bucket full of water. Drop the stone into the water from a height of about 20 centimeters. You will hear the sound of the stone dropping in the water. Now here they are telling us that children, you have to take a bucket full of water and drop the stone into the water from the height of about 20 centimeters. You will hear the sound of the stone dropping in the water. Of course, when you throw any object in the water, you hear the sound. Now drop the same stone into the water from a height of about 100 centimeters. You will hear its sound again. Now whatever object you throw, you will hear the sound. But here they are telling us that first you will throw it at a height of about 20 centimeters, hear the sound. And after that you throw it at a height of about 100 centimeter, you will hear a sound again. Correct. Now what is the question? What is the difference in the sound in the two actions above? What can we conclude from this? Now see children, you do this experiment, you will come to know. But see, if you throw it from the 20 centimeter, from a height of 20 centimeter, you will hear the less sound. And when you are throwing the stone from a height of about 100 centimeter, you will hear more sound. The sound is more compared to the stone which is thrown from the height of 20 centimeter. So here they are telling, if you throw it from a greater distance, means from 100 centimeter from the height, you will hear the louder sound. It is not low sound, it will be the louder than the stone, than the stone thrown from the height of about 20 centimeter. Then the next one. See, the next picture is carrying a load. The action of lifting a sack are shown in the picture. One sack looks empty, the other one is full. What difference do you notice in the way the two sacks are lifted? The gravitational force on the empty sack is less. Then is to say its weight less. See here in the first person, you can see that the gravitational force on the empty sack is less. Why? Because the weight is less. And in the next picture, the second one, where it is considered of the more weight, then you can see the gravitational force on the bigger sack is greater. In other words, the bag weighs more. Means the weight of that bag is more. That's why the gravitational force on the bigger sack is greater. And in the first one, you can see that the gravitational force on the empty sack is less. That is to say that weight is less. So the greater the force must be applied to lift a greater weight. The next one is, do you know? To weigh an object, it is hung from the hook of a spring balance. You should know this, it is very important. The suspended object is pulled downward by the force of gravity. At the same time, the force of the tension in the spring constantly pulls the object upward. The object comes to rest when the tension in the spring and the gravitational force on the object become equal. In this position, the scale on the spring balance shows the gravitational force acting on the object. Which is the weight of the object? The gravitational force acting on an object is called the weight of that object. Now we will see the fourth one. Now what is magnetic force? See, in front of you, you can see the picture of a magnet. Place a magnet on a table. Take a big iron nail towards the magnet. It sticks to the magnet. Now hold the magnet upright in the air, away from the nail. What will happen, children? As we take the magnet away from the iron nail, it does not attract the iron nail as magnetic force decreases. I'm repeating again. As we take the magnet away from the iron nail, it does not attract the iron nail as magnetic force decreases. Magnet is unable to exert force. If the nail is not placed in the range of the magnetic field. Now we will see the fifth one, the frictional force. Now what is a frictional force that we are going to see? In front of you, you can see a picture related with the frictional force, and you all must be knowing what is that. When a carom piece is flicked lightly, it slides over the carom board but stops at a certain distance. And a ball rolling over a flat ground stops at a certain distance. Why does this happen? Why it happens when two surfaces rub against each other, a force of friction is produced. Keep this in mind. When two surfaces rub against each other, a force of friction is produced. This force always acts against direction of motion. A ball rolling over a flat surface stops at certain distance due to friction between the ball and the surface. Got it? So this is the reason they have given. When two surfaces rub against each other, the force of friction comes into play and it always acts against the direction of motion. When a brake is applied while riding a bicycle, it stops after running a short distance. How does the brake work? Between which part is friction produced? So what will be the answer? When brakes are applied while riding a bicycle, frictional force comes to act between the tires of the bicycle and the surface. This force opposes the tendency of the bicycle to stop. Hence, the bicycle has to overcome this force before it stops. The next one is use your brain power. Why is powder sprinkled on the carom board while playing carom? What will be the answer? When powder is sprinkled on a carom board, friction between the coin and the board decreases so that the coin can be pocketed easily. Next one is try this. Take two pieces of smooth paper and two of sand paper and rub them against each other. What do you notice? Now you have to take two pieces of smooth paper and two of sand paper and just go on rubbing against each other. What do you notice? The smooth surface can be easily rubbed against each other because the force of friction between them is less, while a rough surface cannot be easily rubbed against each other because the force of friction between them is much greater. It is possible for us to walk on the ground only because of the force of friction. Now we are walking on the ground. Why it is possible? Because of the force of friction. And if there is no friction, we would slip and fall. That you can see in the picture which is given in front of you. For example, we are very likely to slip while walking on an oily or wet floor. See, in your house also, if the water is spilled and you are walking from that side, see, you may slip. Why? Because there is no friction, we would slip and fall. Now, next one. Why is a wooden plank laid down for pulling out a car which is stuck in mud? When the car is stuck in the mud, the wooden plank is used, means it is laid down. So what is the reason? A force of friction is generated between the wheel and the wooden plank laid down under the car. Hence, it can be pulled out from the mud. In short, the force of friction can either be decreased or increased as desired. Here they are telling us that the force of friction which is generated between the wheel and the wooden plank, it laid down under the car, and that's why it can be pulled out from the mud very easily. And in short, the force of friction can either be decreased or increased as desired. The next one is electrostatic force. Now, what is electrostatic force? First, we will see the definition of electrostatic force and then we will see the example related with electrostatic force. Static electricity is produced on material like rubber, plastic, and ebonite due to friction. The force exerted by such electrically charged materials is called electrostatic force. Here they are telling us that the static electricity which is produced on material, for example like rubber, plastic and ebonite, due to friction, the force is exerted by such electrical charged material. And that is called as electrostatic force. Now in front of you, you can see one picture of a boy and the comb is in hand and how the paper are sticking to that plastic comb. What they are telling us in the first point, spread a small piece of paper on a table. Means the bits of paper you have to spread it on a table. Rub a piece of thermocol or an inflated balloon against silk cloth and bring it near these pieces. Then second one, rub a plastic comb against dry hair and repeat the above activity. Then the third one, rub a peacock feather between two pages of a notebook and bring it near your fingers. What do you see? In the above activity, the piece of paper, hair and the peacock feather are seen to move. Why does this happen? What is the reason for this? Because when a plastic comb is rubbed against the dry hair, comb develop electrostatic charge. In the same way, it is for the inflated balloon also and for the peacock feather also. The next one is combined forces. Now, what is combined forces? While an action is taking place, various types of forces act on the object in question. You might have seen a roller coaster or the juggling of a sailboard on the seashore. A variety of forces act together in these cases. Means there is a different types of forces which you have learned. It act together in these cases. That's why they have given us a variety of forces act together in these cases. And if you want to obtain more information about this type, the word trick science in Google, search on the internet. So what we have learnt, force is required to bring about any action. Force is necessary for making an object move, to change the direction of motion and also to change the shape of an object. There are various types of forces such as muscular force, mechanical force, gravitational force, magnetic force, frictional force and electrostatic force. So I end the lesson here, that is lesson number 10, force and types of force.